Hi friends, good evening to all of you. Today I would like to address you on one important topic of law called jurisdiction under the Civil Procedure Code. As we know that jurisdiction matters in criminal cases as well as in civil cases also, but today I am going to cover jurisdiction under Civil Procedure Code. It means related to civil cases only. We know that the rights have been given to the citizens, parties, etc. And they have also right to enforce their right by way of filing the cases in the court. Therefore, there is a special proverb or famous proverb called ubi jus ibi remedium. It means where there is a right, remedy is there. Therefore, a person cannot be left to be remediless. Therefore, always the courts have been established to give the justice, to entertain the various kinds of civil suits and to adjudicate the matter, to grant the relief, etc. So, first of all, we have to know the meaning of jurisdiction. Jurisdiction, though the word has not been defined under Civil Procedure Code, but it means it is nothing but a power or authority of the court to adjudicate the matter, to hear the matter, to pass the order. Therefore, it is nothing but an authority, power of the court to hear the matter, adjudicate the matter, or to grant the relief, or to pass the order, decree, judgment, etc. And the jurisdiction of the court does not depend upon the will or wish of the parties. Therefore, it is called that neither due to the will or wish of the party, neither the jurisdiction can be granted to a particular court, nor the jurisdiction can be ousted by the agreement between the parties. Suppose X and Y, they have decided that Pune District Court will conduct their cases in case of dispute. Then, in case of dispute, the matter will not go to the Pune court. However, jurisdiction has to be decided on different factors, because the jurisdiction of the court is statutory. It is according to the law of CPC. It is provided under the CPC. Therefore, it does not depend upon the will or wish of the parties. Hence, the will or wish of the party or agreement of the party can neither grant the jurisdiction to a particular court, nor it can ousted the jurisdiction which is vested with the court. Therefore, party by way of writing in the agreement cannot accord the jurisdiction to a particular court. If they have done it, then it cannot be considered by the court, because the jurisdiction is a statutory provision provided under Civil Procedure Code. Now, under Civil Procedure Code, there are different kinds of jurisdiction which we have to know. First of all, territorial jurisdiction. A territorial jurisdiction is such a jurisdiction which depends upon the territory or the property where it is located. For example, if the immovable property is located within the district of Mumbai, then only Mumbai court can have jurisdiction over the issue, and only Mumbai court can decide, and not the court of Pune can decide. Therefore, if the property is, on the contrary, if the property is located within the jurisdiction of Pune, then obviously the court of Pune can decide the matter, can hear the matter, can adjudicate the matter or adjudicate the dispute, and not the any other court other than Pune can decide it. Therefore, territorial means depending upon the territory. The word itself is explanatory, suggestive. However, in some cases, what happens if the property is located at two different districts, which may be at the border? For example, if two districts are there adjoining, A and B, and the property, for example, 10 acre of the land is situated exactly on the border of the two districts. In that case, if dispute arises between two or more persons in respect of the disputed that property, then both the districts will have jurisdiction to decide the case. For example, if the property is at the border of Kolhapur and Satara, for example, both are adjoining district. Then in that case, the party plaintiff can go either to the court of civil court of Satara, or he can also file, or he can choose to go to the Sangli, because both are adjoining districts and the property is located at the border, which comes, some portion of the property comes within the jurisdiction of this district and some portion of the property comes in another district, that is Satara and Sangli. In such a cases, it can be called as a concurrent jurisdiction. Then the option is left to the party, choice is left to the party to approach the court which they like or they wishes. In such a cases only, that is exceptional cases where the concurrent jurisdiction is provided, then party can choose to go. Hope that you have understood this point. Now, pecuniary jurisdiction. Pecuniary jurisdiction, the word itself is explanatory and suggestive. It says that the jurisdiction of the court, the power of the court depends upon the pecuniary value claimed under that suit. For example, if the suit is filed for partition and there are four brothers and the value of the property is, for example, 10 lakhs only, then 1/4 share could be claimed by one brother out of the four brothers. Then he is entitled to 25% of the share in the property. If the value of the property is 10 lakh rupees, in that case, he can claim to the extent of 2,50,000. Therefore, then he has to file a civil suit before the civil judge, junior division. Because according to the CPC, the powers are vested with the civil judge, junior division, up to 5 lakh, they can decide the suit. And if the value of the property or suit or claim increases from more than 5 lakhs to unlimited, then the suit or matter should be filed before the civil judge senior division. Because the civil judge junior division has been assigned a maximum pecuniary jurisdiction up to 5 lakh rupees, and more than 5 lakh, the suit will go before the civil judge senior division. Likewise, those lawyers who are practicing in Mumbai must be knowing that if the value of the property or any claim under a suit is more than 1 crore, if it exceeds more than 1 crore, then the case or civil suit has to be filed before the Honorable High Court of Bombay. On the contrary, if the value claimed is less than or up to 1 crore, then the suit has to be filed before the City Civil Court in Mumbai. That it means the suit jurisdiction of the court depends upon the pecuniary value of the claimed amount or the value of the property, or for example, suit for partition, the amount to which the plaintiff is claiming that relief, that need to be checked and not the entire value of the property. For example, if the value of the property is 2 crore rupees in Mumbai and there are only three brothers, then the person is claiming 66,66,000 rupees, his share only, then the suit for partition has to be filed before the City Civil Court and not the Honorable High Court of Bombay. Because the High Court's jurisdiction started from 1 crore onwards to unlimited. Another kind of jurisdiction is jurisdiction depends upon subject matter of the suit. Some suits are of other natures, like some of the cases are of family court, some of the cases, civil suits are of other natures, like it goes before the industrial court, some goes before the labor court, some goes to the family court, some of the suits goes to the tribunal, etc. In that case, if jurisdiction of the court depends upon subject matter, then it is called jurisdiction of subject matter. Because the labor court or the family matter cannot be decided by civil court, special courts have been assigned for that. And original and appellate jurisdiction. If the suit is filed at the basic court, which has got the jurisdiction, at the first stage, the suit is filed before that court. For example, if the amount of compensation is claimed 4 lakh rupees as a damages and suit is filed before the civil judge junior division, then it can be said that the court has original jurisdiction, because the suit is filed for the first time before the proper court, that is called original jurisdiction. Similarly, in Mumbai, if the value of the property or the amount claimed under suit is more than 1 crore or it exceeds more than 1 crore, then the suit has to be filed before the Honorable High Court. That will be called original jurisdiction. Whereas the appellate jurisdiction, the word is also suggestive. If the matter is filed in appeal, for example, if the suit has been decided by the Honorable High Court, obviously the value of the same is more than 1 crore, then the case has been decided, then the aggrieved party can file appeal before the Honorable High Court. In that case, the appellate court will have appellate jurisdiction. Appellate or revisional court will have appellate jurisdiction. So this is the basic difference, appellate jurisdiction and the original jurisdiction. Now, we have already covered the concurrent jurisdiction and exclusive jurisdiction. Exclusive jurisdiction means, for example, if only X court is having jurisdiction and other than that court does not have jurisdiction. For example, if the property is located in Pune and suit for title is filed before the Pune court and the value of the property is more than 5 lakhs, for example 1 crore, then the suit will be filed before the civil judge senior division of Pune. Only that court will be having exclusive jurisdiction and none other than that court can decide the suit. That is called exclusive jurisdiction. Means except that, no one will have jurisdiction to decide the case. Whereas in case of concurrent jurisdiction, I have already explained, when the jurisdiction is vested with two courts or more than two courts and they have equal powers, for example, if some of the portion of the property is located in Satara and some of the property, same property, is located in Sangli and the property is situated at the border, then either court can have jurisdiction. It depends upon the will and wish of the party where to go. Means even if he goes to the Satara court, civil court, or Sangli court, that will be justifiable. In that case, then party takes a decision according to his convenience. Plaintiff takes decision according to his own convenience. I would like to give another example of concurrent jurisdiction. For example, if a person, defendant, has published defamatory statement in a newspaper at Mumbai against the plaintiff who is also staying at Mumbai, and the defendant is ordinarily staying in Delhi, he has a place of residence or abode at Delhi, in that case the plaintiff can file suit, defamatory suit, to claim the damages against the defendant either at Delhi civil court, or because the place where defendant resides, or the place, that is Mumbai, where the defamatory statement was published in the newspaper. That is called, here he has concurrent jurisdiction. Means both the courts have jurisdiction, but the suit has to be filed at one place only. So I have covered the kinds of jurisdiction. First of all, many things are there which I am going to express here. Now, once the matter or civil suit is filed in the court, then it is presumed that the court has got the jurisdiction, court has power to decide or adjudicate the matter. And anyone who says that the court does not have jurisdiction, definitely defendant will say that the court does not have jurisdiction. Sometime he may say, in that case, the burden of proof that the court does not have jurisdiction is upon the defendant, because he is one who says that the particular court where the case has been filed does not have jurisdiction. Then he, defendant, has to take an objection by way of filing interim application or notice of motion that the court does not have jurisdiction, and in pursuance of section 9(11) of the CPC, he can take the objection that the court does not have jurisdiction. If defendant raises such a question that a particular court does not have jurisdiction, then the preliminary issue has to be raised, has to be framed by the court, for example, whether this court is having jurisdiction or not. And that issue has to be decided firstly instead of going through the all trial of the civil cases, because conducting trial of the suit may take 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. Then so as to avoid the time, first of all, it's court should ensure that whether they are going in a right direction or not, whether the court has jurisdiction or not. Because after conducting a trial for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, then if court comes to know that the court doesn't have jurisdiction, then it will be wrong exercise of the power and wastage of the precious time of the court. Therefore, it is obviously wise to check out whether the court has got the jurisdiction or not. If the defendant has raised this question that this particular court doesn't have jurisdiction, then court has to frame the issue and court has to entertain section 911 application or notice of motion, and hearing on that has to be conducted first, and first that preliminary issue has to be decided, then further course of action and suit can be decided. If the court does not have jurisdiction, because court will check whether the court has jurisdiction or not, obviously the pleadings of the plaintiff through his plaint will be checked. For example, if the property is located at Pune and the dispute is filed in respect of the said property and the court is Pune, then definitely Pune court will have jurisdiction. Second, if the value of the property is, for example, 4 lakh rupees, however the suit is filed before the civil judge senior division, then court will say that the case cannot be filed, suit cannot be filed before the civil judge senior division, it has to go to the junior division only. So from the pleading of the plaintiff only, or from the pleading of the defendant, court will come to know the jurisdiction, whether the court has got the jurisdiction or not. If finally court comes to know that the court does not have jurisdiction, in that case, what is supposed to be done by the court is to return off the plaint to a proper court. For example, if the case was filed before the Pune court, civil judge senior division, and finally court comes to know that objection was raised by the defendant, notice of motion was filed, application was filed by the defendant that court does not have jurisdiction, and finally court comes to know that the Pune court does not have jurisdiction and other court, for example Mumbai court, has got the jurisdiction, then court can do one thing, the administrative department of the court can return the plaint, and judge has to return the plaint according to CPC, because what CPC says, if the court does not have jurisdiction, then the plaint has to be returned to the proper court which has got the jurisdiction. In that case, if in the opinion of the judge, if the Mumbai court has got the jurisdiction, then this plaint has to be returned along with all papers to the Mumbai court. Or a liberty can be given to the plaintiff to withdraw the civil suit. If he wishes to withdraw the suit and if he wants to file the suit at proper court which has got the jurisdiction, then liberty can be given by the court to withdraw the suit. Thereafter, he is at liberty to file or not to file. It is his right, because he will decide. Now, the jurisdiction of the court is very much important, because if the court passes a decree or order or any judgment without having jurisdiction, then whether such a order, judgment or decree has value, any value? No, obviously answer is no, because it is void and it is null and void. The decree passed by the court, order passed by the court having no jurisdiction is nullity. It has zero in the eye of value, therefore it cannot be enforced. Therefore jurisdiction is very much important. And Section 89 of CPC is also relevant from this point of view. For example, if there is an agreement between the two or more than two parties, and in that agreement it is specifically written in one of the paragraphs that in case of dispute or differences between the parties, then the parties can appoint arbitrator. In that case, mistakenly aggrieved party has filed the suit, then court can check the same, or other party, defendant, can also take objection that there is already arbitration clause under the said agreement which is in dispute, therefore the court does not have jurisdiction. Then, according to section 89 of the CPC, the jurisdiction of the court is hit and there is embargo and the court does not have jurisdiction in that case. If there is arbitration clause or separate arbitration agreement is there, then court does not have jurisdiction to decide or hear the matter or hear the civil suit, as the matter need to be decided by the arbitrator according to Arbitration and Conciliation Act. Therefore, the jurisdiction is jurisdiction of the court is taken out or barred by statute. We can say it is barred by statute because two conditions need to be satisfied so as to exercise the jurisdiction. Number one, whether the suit is of civil nature. Second, the suit is not. Two conditions need to be satisfied by the court while checking the jurisdiction. Number one, whether the suit is of civil nature, and second, its cognizance is not expressly or impliedly barred by any statute. Now, suit of civil nature, that is also meaning is also given under the CPC. A suit of political nature, suit of related to any caste or religious purpose, etc., is not a suit of civil nature. Therefore, court cannot decide such a suit. Suit pertaining to political or religious or caste matter is not civil suit. It does not come within the definition of civil suit. Similarly, if the jurisdiction of the court is barred either expressly or impliedly under any statute, then court does not have authority to conduct the case. For example, under section 89 of the CPC, the jurisdiction of the court is hit or there is embargo, because the Arbitration and Conciliation Act says that if there is an arbitration agreement, then only arbitrator has authority to conduct the matter and not the civil court. Likewise, some powers are vested with quasi-judicial authorities like tahsildar, collectors or ministers, etc. In that case, some powers are vested with the tribunals. In that case, the matter has to be filed before the concerned quasi-judicial authority or tribunal only, if law says like that. In that case, if law says that the court does not have jurisdiction, in that case, the jurisdiction of the court is expressly barred by law. We can say rightly like this. Now, foreign court means what? Because to attract the provision of section 10 of the CPC or 11 of the CPC, which says that res judicata or res subjudice, it will be checked whether the court has got the jurisdiction or not. Because section 11 of the CPC says that once the matter has been finally adjudicated upon or decided by the court having jurisdiction to decide the same, the same party or through their representative shall not file the case before the same court or any other court claiming the same relief under the same title, because the suit is already barred, adjudicated upon. Therefore, to attract this provision, one of the elements is that the court which has passed the order or adjudicated upon the matter was having jurisdiction. Therefore, jurisdiction is also important from the viewpoint of section 11 of the CPC. If court does not have jurisdiction and that has decided, then later on it cannot become a res judicata. It can never become a res judicata, because only one argument is there: the court does not, court which has decided the issue was not having a jurisdiction. Similarly, from the viewpoint of section 10 of the CPC, which says that res subjudice means two or more than two court have concurrent jurisdiction, and the suit is filed at one place and the defendant has filed the suit at some other places without any knowledge, etc. In that case, both the courts have jurisdiction, but the case where first case is filed, then the second court should not proceed with the matter because the suit is pending in section 10 of the CPC. Therefore, the jurisdiction is also important from the viewpoint of section 10 res subjudice, as well as from the viewpoint of section 11 res subjudicata, res judicata, sorry. Now what remains now? Section 7 rule, or sorry, order 7 rule 11 of the CPC is also connected with this, which says that the rejection of the plaint, when plaint has to be rejected and when plaint has to be written. When plaint has to be written, when the court does not have jurisdiction, then in that case court has to return the plaint. When there is no jurisdiction, then court has to return the plaint. And on the contrary, order 7 rule 11 of the CPC says that rejection of the plaint, when this plaint is required to be rejected, number one, it does not have cause of action, because the pleading shows that there is no cause of action arose. If there is no cause of action arose, then the suit cannot be entertained, and it is not tenable, because there is no cause of action. Unless there is a cause of action, suit cannot be filed. There has to be cause of action. So if there is no cause of action, then plaint can be rejected. Number two, the amount of the claimed is undervalued. For example, some of the plaintiff, to avoid to pay the heavy court fees, they show that the value of the property is less. For example, if the value of the property is 5 crore rupees, but they show that it is only 90 lakhs, below 1 crore, just to avoid to pay the court fees. In that case, on that ground also, plaint can be rejected under order 7 rule 11 of the CPC. On the contrary, if the value of the property is correctly shown, for example, if the value of the property is 5 crore and 5 crore is rightly written and claimed properly, it is properly valued, the claim is properly valued, however the court fees is not paid, in that case also the plaint is liable to be rejected under order 7 rule 11 of the CPC. And if suit is barred by any law, or the plaints have not been filed in duplicate, in such a cases also the plaint is liable to be rejected under order 7 rule 11 of the CPC. Hope that I have covered the many provisions related to jurisdiction, and if I have not covered anything, then we can cover it in next session. Thanks for hearing to me, Advocate Shahid Ali Ansari.